Good morning. Not a whole lot of announcements today. Our youth rally is today, starting at 2:30. If you're not involved with that, at least please pray about it. There's a little bit of concern, at least yesterday, that we're going to get some rain, some thunderstorms during the youth rally. The last forecast I heard was partly cloudy. No rain until later tonight. So I hope that that holds up. I hope that that's true. But yeah, at least please pray for the youth rally. Pray that kids will be uplifted in Christ. And if they're not saved, that they'll be saved. And that they'll have a good time and they'll be safe. We have a blood drive coming up on the 15th. You can sign up. You can schedule an appointment for that at redcrossblood.org. Our church picnic is on August 20th at 5. Please sign up on the bulletin board for that with how many people are coming and what you plan on bringing. A bunch of Bible studies coming up in September. They're Sunday morning, Sunday evening, and Wednesdays. There's a lot going on Wednesdays, so see if there's anything that fits into your schedule and maybe you can attend a Bible study. Anything I missed? Anybody have anything else? All right, let's stand and we'll read scripture and pray, and the ushers looking forward. Now in a great house, there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, some for honorable use, some for dishonorable. Therefore, if anyone cleanses himself from what is dishonorable, he will be a vessel for honorable use, set apart as holy, useful to the master of the house, ready for every good work. Thanks, Father, for your word. Thank you for what it teaches us and teaches us about life and teaches us about you. I pray that we'll use it to do that, use it to enlighten us about you, that we will grow in you and grow as Christians. I want to pray for our youth rally, that you will bless it, Lord, that everyone will be safe. Bless the people who are working so hard to put it together. Pray that the kids will be uplifted in you, that they will grow in you and be saved if they aren't saved. Pray for our offering as well, that you will use it for your honor and for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Welcome to Grace Chapel this morning. Good to see all your smiling faces. Now smile. Okay. Please stand as we worship in song this morning. Our first scripture comes from Isaiah 61. Arise, shine, for the Lord, for the light has come, and the glory of the Lord is upon thee. And we're going to sing Shine, Jesus, Shine this morning.
Thine all.
scripture this morning comes from Psalms 148, 13. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for his name alone is excellent. His glory is above all earth and heaven. And we're going to sing, Lord, I lift your name on high this morning.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my day. From the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt you paid, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt you paid, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Amen. And the next song, our final scripture, comes from Matthew 22:37. Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. And 1 Samuel 12:24. Only fear the Lord and serve him in truth with all your heart, for consider how great things he hath done for you. And we're going to sing the greatest thing this morning.
The greatest thing in all my life is knowing you. The greatest thing in all my life is knowing you. I want to know you more. I want to know you. In all my life is knowing you. The greatest thing in all my life is loving you. The greatest thing in all my life is loving you. I want to love you more. I want to love you more. The greatest thing in all my life is loving you. The greatest thing in all my life is serving you. The greatest thing in all my life
you're singing, you may be seated. Children just dismissed for junior church, and we'll turn the service over to our pastor.
Good morning, Grace Chapel. So thankful to be with you all here today. If you'd please begin by turning with me to 1 Samuel chapter 14. I'm going to pick up again here in the text. And before we begin, I just want to say again a big thank you to everybody that has come so far to help in preparation for the youth rally and everyone in advance that's going to come today. It is a lot of work for a one-day event. But we are very proud to be able to host it, and many hands make light work. We can't do it alone. So thank you all so much to everybody that has come and helped. And along those lines, if you are going to be helping today, we would like to get everybody together at 2 o'clock for a group picture from Grace Chapel. Every year we get a group picture of everybody, but we don't get necessarily a specific picture of the people who have made it happen. So we'd like to get together. The event starts at 2:30, so at 2 o'clock we will be able to get together, and we're going to take a moment and pray for the event. Again, pray that nobody gets hurt. We tried to make things as foolproof as possible, but it's still going to be, we tried to go big with a few things this year too. So we want to find a balance between, you know, going big and like not getting hurt. So we need to pray for that. Pray that the weather goes away, or the bad weather goes away. We want the good weather to come, right? We looked at the weather forecast the last few days, and it went from being perfect and ideal to being less than perfect and not ideal to being pretty good now. So I got more faith in God than weathermen anyways, but we do want to have a time of dedicated prayer at the beginning, and we'll take a picture together so that we can tell the world how wonderful you are for helping. So that is the hope today, and again, thank you so much to everybody that's made this possible. So again, we're going to be in 1 Samuel chapter 14. And this morning, before we begin, I have a picture I want to show you on this slideshow. And I want to ask you, how many of you are people who do this morning? Do we have anybody? Okay, we got a proud person in the back, hand raised high. Is there anybody else that you will not compromise and you will use every last, I don't know what you call it. I was trying to think, and I don't think toothpaste comes out in drops, but every last drop, we'll say drop. You're somebody that uses every last drop. So we got a couple people that are proud about it. I know some people I've seen at times, there was at least one couple I knew, and there was kind of this debate between the spouses, and they're going to be like, who is going to be the one that's going to finally cave and pitch it? So they're like going back and forth time and time again, and who's going to be the one that finally says, I'm done with this, I can't handle it anymore? Just this morning, funny enough, I don't think my daughter's ever brushed her teeth before church. And this morning she comes to me and says, Dad, I need to use your toothpaste because mine's all gone. And I said, no, it's actually not. Like, check this out. You run it along the edge of the counter and you get some more. Well, I am what some people would consider a pretty frugal person. I might even be considered cheap by some people, perhaps in my family. This is one thing I don't have the patience for. Like, I don't know, maybe it's something that God wants to grow in me. But I am the person that I don't like a workout, a back and arm workout when I'm trying to brush my teeth. I don't like brushing my teeth to take 10 minutes just so I can save, like, I don't even know how much you would really save. But if you're in this category, God bless you. I'm thankful for you. But I'm sure that all of us somewhere have an area of life where we like to get our money's worth, right? Maybe you're not the guy or a girl that works over the toothpaste for 3 extra weeks, but you might be somebody when you go to the buffet, you have to leave in physical pain because otherwise you didn't get your money's worth. And then you find out it's actually not worth it to get your money's worth at that capacity, because then the good memory turned into not so good of a memory. I love buffets. If I have the option to go out to eat somewhere and one option's a buffet and the other option's not, I'm just the buffet guy, the all-you-can-eat person. I like to get my money's worth. And that's kind of the camp I come from. Just this last week, we were at Knoebels, right? And we were at Knoebels on Friday on bargain night. Bargain night, it's cheap, and for one price, you get to ride all night long. So don't you know, they are open until 9 o'clock, and we were there at 8:55, like, hey, can we get one more ride? And then all of a sudden, it's 9:15, and you're like, wait, the lights are still on. Maybe we could get one more ride. Because we like to get our money's worth. I'm sure there's not a single person on the face of the planet that's like, I just like throwing money away, and I don't really care if I get my money's worth. We like to get our money's worth, whether it's toothpaste or Knoebels or the buffet or wherever it might be. And in my life recently, I've been considering this concept, and I've actually grown to believe that in some ways this roll of toothpaste that looks ridiculous, tube of toothpaste, on the screen is actually a bit of a role model for me. And the reason is that tube of toothpaste, that the owner of that toothpaste really got their money's worth out of it. And in my life, I want to consider that when God uses me in this life, I want at the end of my life to look like that. Where people can look at my life and God can look at my life, and when I stand before my Creator, He can say, I got my money's worth out of you. Where He can, not literally money's worth, because the thing we want to remember too is that when God purchased us back to Himself, He purchased us not with silver or gold or perishable things, but with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And if He was willing to give His Son for you and I, don't we want God to be able to get every last drop out of who we are? That we can live our lives with such devotion to God that when we get to glory, He says, I was not limited at all in how I could use you. You are one that was completely surrendered to me in everything, and I was able to use every last drop of you, and I got my money's worth out of you. I want us that to be our thought today. So this is my prayer and aim in life ever since I thought about this. Brush my teeth, and I think I want to look like that. I want God to be able to use me in such a way. I'm not advocating for burnout. I'm not saying that you should work yourself till you die, but we should desire as believers to be used by God. And not just used sparingly, but used fully, that all of our gifts, our talents, our abilities, our time, our money, our resources, everything that we have is at His disposal, and He's fully used us. And so the tendency for a lot of people, though, is to use others rather than to be used. A lot of people would rather use other people for their own benefit or add God to the list of other things in their life and try to get benefit from God instead of just serving Him. See, a lot of people like to live with Jesus as Savior, but the problem comes when we live with Jesus as Lord. Right? Because if Jesus is going to be the Lord of our life, it means He's the boss, He's the king, He's the ruler. It means He's everything. He's our owner, right? It's easy to live with Him as Savior because you enjoy the benefits. But I want us to consider as we dive into this text today, do we live in such a way that God can use us? Do we live under Christ's Lordship so that we're fully surrendered to Him? I want you to keep these things in mind. Now, a quick recap before we dive into this week's text. Last week, we ended with really good news. If you've been here a number of weeks with us, you find out the book of 1 Samuel is very much like a roller coaster with its ups and downs. Some weeks we come to church and I say, here's this guy, he kind of messed stuff up a lot, do not be like this guy at all. And then there's other weeks where it's like, hey, this went really well, this you should strive to be more like this person. There's ups and downs. And last week we actually had the privilege of seeing good news for once, right? Because Jonathan, the son of Saul, the son of King Saul, he had this idea and he said, you know, God is able to save with two guys just as much as He is with an army. And so Jonathan, with his great faith, he stepped out and he put this condition out to God and he said, God, I'm going to believe You're sending me if the Philistines come down to me, these different things. And so God ends up giving him this wonderful victory. He answers his prayer, and because of Jonathan's faith, Israel ended up having this great victory. I challenged you last week to have the perhaps of faith, right? To believe God for good things in our lives, not just for bad things, not to just be realistic, not to be pessimistic, but to believe that God is a miracle working God and He can work in our situations. And so Jonathan won this very great victory, so much so that King Saul, the whole army, everybody got involved once the victory was sure. Things went from being very bleak to being completely awesome for them in a moment's time. And so that's where our story picks up. We pick up leaving off with very good news, and that's where our text picks up. We're going to look at verse 24 in chapter 14 this morning. The text says, "And the men of Israel had been hard-pressed that day, so Saul had laid an oath on the people, saying, 'Cursed be the man who eats food until it is evening, and I am avenged on my enemies.' So none of the people had tasted food." So in the midst of this great victory that God gave to Israel, to Jonathan, there's a bit of a shadow. Right, things, it was really good news, God was working, things were going great, but there was one problem. Saul was so greedy, he said, you know what, I want victory so bad, we're not going to take a break for lunch. I don't know if anybody ever worked for somebody that didn't allow you a lunch break, but I don't really particularly appreciate that kind of a person. I don't know if anyone's pointing fingers. I hope not. Where all of a sudden you go and you realize you've been working all day. They say, we don't have time to even stop to eat. And this is what Saul is doing. So the people here are hard-pressed. They're not hard-pressed by Jonathan, not by God, but Saul is driving these people into the ground. And so he puts forth this foolish and rash oath, and he says, you guys must swear, if you eat before dinner time, you can't have breakfast, you can't have lunch, you can't have your afternoon snack or whatever else you want to call it, you can't have second breakfast, you can't eat any of these things, we're not going to eat until the dinner time, until I have them avenged on my enemies. So Saul begins with this kind of abuse of his leadership authority, right? He wasn't thinking about the good of others. He was thinking about himself. And Jonathan, we saw last week, Jonathan was willing to sacrifice himself on behalf of the army. But now Saul is saying, I'm willing to sacrifice these guys for my own betterment. See, Saul was focused more on himself and his own glory than the benefit of others. And Saul at this time, I dare say he probably did not spend much time recalling his farming days, right? Saul had been, at that point in time, as far as national figures were concerned, he was a nobody. Nobody knew who Saul was. Nobody knew his name. And God took Saul from being a nobody in the middle of nowhere in this small town with a bad reputation. And God said, Saul, I'm going to call you to lead my people. I'm going to take you from the very bottom to the very top. And so when Saul received this wonderful benefit, he kind of forgot. And he grew to abuse his leadership authority. He forgot where he had come from. And I want to remind all of us, if God ends up giving you any position in life, or if you ever end up having authority over other people, remember that God was the one who brought good things into your life. Remember the grace of God, because sometimes people forget what it was like when they were at the bottom of the ladder, when they get to the top and they mistreat people. And this is what happened in Saul's life. And see, Saul was all about his own mission and his own glory. Last week we saw Jonathan said, we're going to go fight these uncircumcised Philistines. So Jonathan addressed the Philistines, the enemies of God's people, as that, as the enemies of God. They're outside of covenant with God. But here we see Saul saying, we're going to go fight these guys. They're my enemies. So Saul is fighting his own battles, his own vendetta, his own plan, instead of fighting God's battles as his son Jonathan did. So we're going to see how this oath pans out. If you look at verse 25, it says, now when all the people came to the forest, behold, there was honey on the ground. And when the people entered the forest, behold, the honey was dropping, but no one put his hand to his mouth, for the people feared the oath. So Saul had made the people swear this oath, you're not allowed to eat till dinner time. And as such, these guys, they've been fighting all day, they're exhausted, they're hungry. They end up in this forest and they see this nice honey dropping down. And they look at it, and because they were afraid of this oath they had sworn, they were afraid of a curse, they said, we're not going to touch it with a 10-foot pole, right? We're not going to do anything. You can remember Snickers made a thing where they said, you're not yourself when you're hungry. Right, it's this whole slogan, and then they take this sweet lady and they turn her into the Incredible Hulk because she's hungry. And different times people will get hungry and then get hangry, and but no one's really themselves when they're hungry. And you can imagine these soldiers are out fighting all day long. Surely they could have used some food, but they're scared of this oath, so they decide we're not going to partake, we're going to skip the honey, we're just going to keep moving, we're going to do our part in this oath. But then the text says in verse 27 that Jonathan had not heard his father charge the people with the oath. So he put out the tip of the staff that was in his hand, and he dipped it in the honeycomb, and he put his hand to his mouth, and his eyes became bright. And then one of the people said, your father strictly charged the people with an oath, saying, cursed be the man who eats food this day. And the people were faint. So Jonathan was MIA when this all happened. Right, Jonathan was the guy who had always taken initiative when his father Saul was doing nothing. Jonathan said, let's believe God for something awesome and go to fight, while Saul was reserved and staying back and doing nothing. And so Jonathan, of course, wasn't there at this time when they decided to put forth this ridiculous oath. And as such, these guys are walking through the forest, they're hungry, and he sees some honey and says, why not? I'm hungry. The honey's free if it's in the wild, I'm assuming, so might as well enjoy it, because all these guys are faint. He has no idea about the oath, and of course they inform him afterwards He goes and eats this honey, and then the guys say, hey, by the way, your dad had this really bad idea this morning, and we're not supposed to eat today. But Jonathan had absolutely no idea. So then we'll see what Jonathan responds. If you look at verse 29, Jonathan said, my father has troubled the land. See how my eyes have become bright because I tasted a little of this honey. How much better if the people had eaten freely today of the spoil of their enemies that they found. For now the defeat among the Philistines has not been great. So Jonathan here defends his actions. He points out how bad of an idea this was. I mean, you can imagine if you were in this army and you're out fighting all day, you would naturally be hungry. One of my favorite verses in the New Testament, I think it's hilarious, it makes me smile every time, comes when Jesus was facing the temptation in the wilderness. Right? Jesus was facing the temptation in the wilderness, Satan came to him. And the scripture says in the New Testament that after Jesus fasted 40 days, he was hungry. And that just cracks me up every time, because I'm not an inspired author of scripture, but I kind of saw that one coming. Does anybody else? You're reading it, it's this divine account of how Jesus is the second Adam, overcomes temptation, and it's this awesome thing, and I'm like, yeah, didn't eat for 40 days and he's hungry. Shocker. I did not see that coming at all, right? So these guys are kind of in this camp. They're walking, they're fighting, they're doing all this stuff, and they're naturally exhausted, right? That's just kind of what happens. And so Jonathan points out, like, this is such a dumb idea. These guys have been fighting all day. Don't you know that tired guys don't fight as good? Like, and they don't have food. They need this nourishment and different things. We were setting up for the youth rally yesterday, and it's hot and it's sunny. We're not swinging swords. We're making water slides and stuff. And I'm out there, like, I need some lunch. I'm kind of dying over here. I need a Gatorade. I need something. And you got guys out there fighting. And Saul says, no, you're not allowed to eat until I get vengeance on my enemies. So Jonathan points out how foolish this was, said that we would have gotten twice the victory. If the guys could have eaten, they would have been fighting so much better. What in the world were we thinking? And then the text continues in verse 31, and it says, they struck down the Philistines that day from Michmash to Ajalon, and the people were very faint. The people pounced on the spoil and took sheep and oxen and calves, and they slaughtered them on the ground, and the people ate them with the blood. So in spite of Saul, not because of Saul, but in spite of Saul, God continues to bring them victory. Now, nobody here probably knows where this Ajalon and Michmash is at, but they chased the Philistines about 15 to 20 miles. Right? So Saul is putting these guys to work. He says, until we receive vengeance on my enemies, the Philistines, who are really God's enemies, until this happens, you guys are going to work your tails off. Until this happens, you're going to be so hungry, all these different things, but you are going to work and work and work and work. So they chase the enemy 15 to 20 miles. So we're talking about some really tired, exhausted guys. And so they get there, and evening comes, and the people are so starving that when they finally, the evening comes, they're allowed to eat again. They rush upon some of the spoil, and it says that they eat the animals with the blood. And so that probably doesn't make some sense to some people. But basically, the sheep, the oxen, the calves, the things they were eating was okay, according to the Old Testament law. But they were commanded, they were supposed to have the meat from these animals to drip dry, essentially, of the blood. Because God says blood is given for atonement. God said the life source of an animal is in the blood. So as such, you shouldn't just dive right in. And plus, it's kind of gross, too. So this was God's desire. This was God's plan. But you can kind of imagine that after these guys had been chasing their enemy for up to 20 miles and working and fighting and different things, that they get up and they get the opportunity to have a steak. Do they really want to wait for it to drip and wash it and all this stuff? They don't want to wait. They're ready to eat. Like, they're just willing to jump it right in. And so as such, they end up compromising, doing something they weren't allowed to do according to the Old Testament because they were so desperate. And I know that some of us at times, if you have dinner plans and you find out you have to wait, what do? You change your plans. Because when we're hungry, we don't like to wait. On my birthday, we were going to be going to Olive Garden because I love unlimited food. And you can get unlimited soup, salad, and breadsticks. And we went there and they said, you got to wait an hour and a half. And I said, no, we don't. We were going somewhere else to eat. It was like, as much as I love that, nothing is worth waiting an hour and a half for when you're already hungry. And this is where these guys find themselves here today. Now, I hope as I'm talking about food and waiting and everything else, my message is going to be just as long as it always is. I'm sorry. So turn the food part of your brain off for a few minutes this morning and bear with me. But these guys, they waited till the evening. They're technically off the hook as far as this oath was concerned, right? Saul had told them, you can't eat until dinner time. We're going to go and fight. I'm going to work you. We'll eat at dinner time. So they're off the hook regarding this oath that they had made, but they're compromising against God by not eating the way they were supposed to. So we're going to see how King Saul responds. If you look at verse 33, it says, then they told Saul, behold, the people are sinning against the Lord by eating with the blood. And Saul said, you've dealt treacherously. Roll a great stone to me here. And Saul said, disperse yourselves among the people and say to them, let every man bring his ox or his sheep and slaughter them here and eat. And do not sin against the Lord by eating with the blood. So every one of the people brought his ox with him that night, and they slaughtered them there. And Saul built an altar to the Lord. It was the first altar that he built to the Lord. So Saul, King Saul, he's brought up to speed. And the people say, hey, Saul, these guys are sinning over here. They're just going right after these animals. They didn't let the meat drip out and different things. And Saul responds, and Saul says, they have dealt treacherously. Right? These guys have sinned against the Lord. This is Saul's response. And I don't know if you remember, I believe it was 2 weeks ago now, maybe 3 weeks ago, but do you remember when Saul was confronted regarding his sin, what his response was? Right, Samuel the prophet came and confronted King Saul and said, Saul, you have sinned. And what's Saul do? He comes up with a mile-long list of excuses, and he blames other people. Right? He basically says, Samuel, you were late to the appointed time. Samuel, this is more your fault than mine. And the army is scattering. It's more their fault than mine. And the Philistines had got this huge army. It's more their fault than mine. Samuel, really, I'm pretty innocent, you know. I didn't really sin that much. It's kind of your fault anyways. This is Saul's response when he is confronted about his sin. But when somebody else tells Saul, hey, these other guys are sinning over here, all of a sudden King Saul shows up and says, you guys are dealing treacherously. All of a sudden, Saul really cares about sin when it doesn't occur in his own life. Don't you know this? And isn't this a tendency that people have at times? Right? Jesus said it this way. He said that we're supposed to take the log out of our own eye before we take the speck out of somebody else's eye. Doesn't mean that you can't ever offer judgment, and church discipline is still a thing, and there's different times for this. But it's so easy for us as human beings to let ourselves off the hook and really give it to other people, isn't it? Well, all of a sudden, Saul had sinned, and Saul's looking for grace, but the other guys have sinned, and Saul immediately says, these guys are treacherous. They're sinning against the Lord, and it's easy for him to point fault at other people. So Saul goes, he builds an altar, he's trying to do things publicly right. This is kind of a problem in Saul's life, is he likes to use people, and Saul likes to use God. When it's convenient for Saul, he's willing to do the rituals. He's willing to do the ceremonies. He's willing to do the public God things when it's convenient for him. And he's willing to use God, but he's not willing to be someone that's willing to be used. And so now that it's evening, the men are refreshed. We're going to see where the text goes next in verse 36. It says that Saul said, let us go down after the Philistines by night and plunder them until the morning light. Let us not leave a man of them. And they said, do whatever seems good to you. But the priest said, let us draw near to God here. And Saul inquired of God, shall I go down after the Philistines? Will you give them into the hand of Israel? But God did not answer Saul that day. So once again, Saul has his own idea. And Saul's idea is to once again push his men beyond their limits. Right? Saul does not look at his soldiers as men that are created in the image of God. Right? Men who deserve respect and deserve to be treated properly. He has run them ragged all day. And what's his conclusion? Well, now that you guys have had some food, let's fight till the morning. Let's fight all the way through the night. He's willing to drive these guys completely into the dirt. So this is his idea. And his army, they're nice guys, and they say, you're the king, do whatever seems good to you. But then suddenly the priest has this idea and says, maybe we should ask God about this. Maybe we should see what God thinks before we go and fight into the midnight hour and all these different things. And so they go up and they decide to pray and they ask God about these things. And don't you know that God is silent? God doesn't tell Saul, go fight. God doesn't tell Saul not to go fight. God does not respond to Saul. And personally, I believe it's because Saul is once again using God. It's the last minute thing. God is always the last option for Saul. And Saul only uses God when it's convenient for him. Right? Saul doesn't desire to be a vessel to be used by God. He's the one that is using God instead. So we're going to see how Saul reacts to God's silence. In verse 38, Saul said, "Come here, all you leaders of the people, and know and see how this sin has arisen today. For as the Lord lives who saves Israel, though it be in Jonathan my son, he shall surely die." But there was not a man among all the people who answered him. So then he said to all Israel, "You shall be on one side, and I and Jonathan my son will be on the other side." And the people said to Saul, "Do what seems good to you." Therefore Saul said, "O Lord God of Israel, why have you not answered your servant this day? If this guilt is in me or in Jonathan my son, O Lord God of Israel, give Urim, but if this guilt is in your people Israel, give Thummim." And Jonathan and Saul were taken, but the people escaped. And then Saul said, "Cast the lot between me and my son Jonathan," and Jonathan was taken. So Saul concludes that because God was silent, there must be some sin in the camp. But don't you know it's just like Saul to not look at his own life again, right? So Saul concludes God is silent because there's some sin somewhere. Somebody else must have sinned. Somebody else must have caused some problems because King Saul never did anything wrong, right? This is how he views himself. So they go through this process to try to figure out what's going on. And Saul makes this rash vow and he says, "Whoever has disobeyed this oath, we're going to kill him." No thought given, no consideration. It says, even if Jonathan, my son, no matter who it is, if anybody is compromised, we're going to kill him. This is Saul's plan. So then they put forth this test with Urim and Thummim. These are some sort of special lot that was kept in the priest's garment. And it was like they would cast these out and it would decipher between two different things. It would almost be like probably a spiritual version of heads or tails. Kind of something like that, where he says, all right, heads, it's Jonathan or me, or tails, it's everybody else. Something like that. So they cast these lots, and all of a sudden they find out, oh, wait, it's not the people, it's either Saul or Jonathan. Cast it again, find out Jonathan has done something. So through this process of determination, they find out, for some reason, Jonathan appears to be the guilty party. So all of this seems ridiculous, right? And Saul had said, whoever this falls on, we're going to kill him. So we're going to see if Saul's a man of his word. Verse 43, then Saul said to Jonathan, "Tell me what you've done." And Jonathan told him, "I tasted a little honey with the tip of my staff that was in my hand. Here I am, I will die." And Saul said, "God do so to me and more also, you shall surely die, Jonathan." But then the people said to Saul, "Shall Jonathan die who has worked this great salvation in Israel? Far from it. As the Lord lives, there shall not one hair of his head fall to the ground, for he has worked with God this day." So the people ransomed Jonathan so that he did not die. And then Saul went up from pursuing the Philistines, and the Philistines went to their own place. So this is a crazy idea that Saul has, right? He goes through this process and says, whoever has disobeyed this oath, we're going to kill him. And then they find out that for whatever reason, he goes through this, and Jonathan had partaken of some honey. Now, mind you, Jonathan was not actually guilty because Jonathan didn't make this ridiculous oath. Jonathan was out fighting. Jonathan was by himself. But Saul concludes we should go and kill him. And this is the same Jonathan who last week with two guys climbed up this rocky hill to fight the Philistines. And God delivered him and gave him this great victory. And now all of a sudden his dad thinks it's a good idea to kill him. And if it wasn't for the people who ransomed him and said, look, Jonathan has worked with God. Jonathan's the best guy we got. What in the world are you thinking, Saul? And so they actually ransom Jonathan's life to save him. But Saul has officially blown it as king because he has shown everybody how truly rash and irresponsible he is. Right? He's willing to use God and use other people to the point where he has these ideas and he's going to run his guys ragged into the midnight hour, do all these terrible things, and then says, whoever is hindering us, even if it's Jonathan, whatever's going on, I'm going to kill my own son. And so this day that began with a miraculous deliverance that God gave to Jonathan ends with everybody going home, pretty much with their tail between their legs, because King Saul has utterly failed as a king. And now the text is going to close in verses 47 to 52, kind of a summary of Saul's reign here. It says, when Saul had taken the kingship over Israel, he fought against all his enemies on every side, against Moab, against the Ammonites, against Edom, against the kings of Zobah, and against the Philistines. And wherever he turned, he routed them. And he did valiantly, and he struck the Amalekites and delivered Israel out of the hands of those who plundered them. And now the sons of Saul were Jonathan, Ishvi, and Malchishua. And the names of his two daughters were these. The name of the firstborn was Merab, and the name of the younger was Michal. And the name of Saul's wife was Ahinoam, the son of Ahimaaz. And the name of the commander of the army was Abner, the son of Ner, Saul's uncle. Kish was the father of Saul, and Ner, the father of Abner, was the son of Abiel. And there was hard fighting against the Philistines all the days of Saul. And when Saul saw any strong man or any valiant man, he attached him to himself. So we get this in closing today, this summary of Saul's reign at this time. How is King Saul doing? What's his reign like? And basically, Saul is fighting against enemies on every side. Basically, Israel, even though they're on land, is like an island unto themselves. They got enemies all around. Things aren't really going too hot there. But the thing is, God was gracious during this time. He brought deliverance to Saul and Israel in spite of Saul's terrible job as king, basically. And I want to point out this morning what Dale Davis shares, biblical commentator. I thought this was very good, about the difference between an outward or historical estimate of King Saul and an inward or covenantal with God estimate. See, we look at Saul's life at this time, and you look at what he was doing, and Saul's names would have been in the headlines. Wouldn't they have been? Right? King Saul is going out and fighting, and things are going good, and not to mention there was times he would take credit for other people's victories, but publicly, out in the open, everything looked good. Everybody's determination, if you would have looked at his poll ratings from the people of Israel, they would have said his polls would have looked good. Everything on the surface looked good for King Saul. But what was the problem? Saul's heart wasn't right. And we see this time and time again. Saul was willing to abuse his leadership authority. Saul was willing to use other people for his own benefit. And Saul would use God when it was convenient to him. Right, we saw the summary statement that Saul did not have a heart after God. Why? Because he was willing to compromise. And when he compromised and when he sinned and when he was confronted, Saul never once at any point admits he ever did anything wrong. Never once did Saul own up to his failures or anything like this. He never owned up to his sin. He would compromise and then he would make excuses. And so even though outwardly everything looked great, Saul was not a good king. And I want to challenge us, especially this morning as believers, that we must be incredibly careful not to measure success like the world does. Right? Through the world's eyes, Saul was a great leader. But through God's eyes, Saul was rejected because his heart wasn't right. And we look at our lives, and perhaps this is your situation. Perhaps you have more money than you had last year, and your savings and your investments and everything else, they're doing good. Things are going good for you in this life. Maybe you got married. Maybe you had a baby. Maybe you had a grandbaby, or your daughter or daughter-in-law had a grandbaby, technically. Maybe you bought a new car. Maybe you graduated college. Maybe you started a new job, or you started your own business, and your business is doing very good. Maybe you built a new house, or maybe things are just going good for you outwardly in all these areas. And I want to tell you this morning, if your life looks good by the world's standards, but your covenant with God is not looking good, then you failed at what matters most, right? Because the world will look at you and tell you you're successful with all these things the world can see, but if your heart isn't right with God, none of those things matter. Doesn't matter how much money you have, how nice your stuff is, doesn't matter what relationships or influence you might have. What matters most is our relationship with God. Are we living under the lordship of Christ as we made a covenant to do, or is our heart not right with God? See, because Saul, again, was inwardly failing. His heart was far from God, right? He was not following God as he was supposed to be, but his name was written in lights and everything was looking good. In man's estimation, Saul was doing great, but in God's estimation, Saul was a failure. So I want us to consider this morning. And so we should learn from this passage today that as God's people, we should seek to be used by God for the good of others rather than trying to use God and others for our own betterment or our own glory or in fulfillment of our own ideas. See, we see time and time again in this text that Saul was a terrible king to follow. I mean, can you imagine working for this guy who will run you ragged and then run you ragged again and not even let you break for lunch? Right? This is the kind of king that Saul was. He was rash. He was drastic. He had these crazy ideas he'd throw out, and then he wouldn't follow through. He would treat others poorly. He didn't consider other human beings as created in the image of God. Right? This is the king that Saul was in his failures. But I want to tell you this morning, I am so thankful that we serve a better king than Saul. Do you think about this? So Saul was a terrible king to follow. These guys had to serve him and subject themselves to this guy that would constantly let them down. See, where Saul was rash and he had this crazy ideas he'd just throw out, do you know that God is both the beginning and the end? God knows the beginning from the end. God knows the day that you'll be born, the day that you'll die. He's the only one that can see all of it perfectly. And as such, God is not a rash God. God is not a last-minute throwing out crazy ideas, right? God is not reckless. God had a plan from before the foundation of the world that there would be a lamb slain for sinners. This was God's plan from before time. God is not rash. God is not panicked. God does not act like King Saul did. Similarly, Saul treated people poorly, right? He treated people poorly. He didn't care for them as human beings made in the image of God. Do you know that God is our creator, loves us as his creation, and that God desires good things for us? God's disposition towards us is good, unlike King Saul's disposition towards his people. And another thing that's wonderful about God as our king today is that God not only can make wonderful and great promises, God actually follows through on his promises. And he will perfectly fulfill every promise that he has made to you and to me. Right? King Saul promised, he vowed this vow, he said, whoever the lot falls on, we're going to kill him. And then he changed his mind. He didn't fulfill his word. He didn't follow through. Thank God he didn't follow through, but he didn't. But when God makes promises to you and I, don't you know that God is a promise-keeping, covenant-keeping God? The scripture says that God promised before time that we would have hope for eternal life and that God does not lie. And the wonderful thing is that you can enter into covenant with this king today. If you place your faith in the Savior, if you believe that Jesus died for you in your place, and you believe that with all your heart, and you believe that God vindicated him and raised him from the dead on the third day, you profess him to be the true Lord, you can be saved from your sin today. And you can enter into a relationship with the king who loved you so much that he did not spare his own son. He gave his son for you while you were still a sinner. When you completely didn't deserve it, by grace, God made a way for you and I to be saved. He's not a rash king. He's not a king who hates us. He's not a king who's unable to fulfill his promises. He's a good king. And we have the privilege to follow him today. And if you don't have assurance and you don't know if you've been saved or you don't know what this looks like or anything like this, please talk to us after the service, because you can enter into a relationship with this king today. And now as we close, I have a few takeaways for you all and something to take into your week with you as well. First, what we learn about God. Well, one is that God doesn't like to be used or to feel used. God doesn't like when we have our outward religious displays when our hearts are far from him. God doesn't like to just be again, as I mentioned last week, God doesn't like to be the emergency brake in our lives. He would rather be the steering wheel. And Saul's habit is to always run to God at the very last minute, to use God for himself and his own purposes. Remember, Saul's aim today was Saul was going to get vengeance on his enemies. Saul was fighting his own battles. He was not fighting God's, whereas Jonathan would go and fight God's battles. So God does not desire to be used in that way. And what we learn about us, again, one thing we should take away is that we should be careful in what we say. Right? Saul was very rash, coming out with these crazy oaths, these crazy vows, all these things, and then Saul ended up not being a man of his word. And the New Testament tells us as believers that we should not make vows. We should have our yes be yes and our no be no. As believers, God desires us to follow in his footsteps and to be true to our word. And again, that God does not appreciate our outward religious actions if our hearts are far from him. See, God desires to have our hearts. God wants outward obedience, yes. But God wants our obedience to him to spring from the heart, to have a heart after God, to have a heart full of worship and adoration for our King who gave so much for us, instead of it just being these motions that we go through. And so as we close this morning, I want you to look at your own life, and I want to ask you, are you one who is typically using others and typically using God, or do you find yourself as one who desires to be used by God for the betterment of others? Again, Saul would willingly use other people for his own good instead of serving other people, and Saul would always use God for what Saul wanted instead of doing what God wanted with his own abilities and different things. So I want to ask you that this morning. Do you ever consider how you are supposed to use our gifts, right, our talents, our abilities, again, our resources, everything that we have in life at God's disposal, or do we try to use him as the cherry on top of our own lives? I want you to look over your life this morning, and I want to ask you where your heart is at. I began this morning with the toothpaste illustration. And one of the reasons I like the toothpaste thing, and I like to think about it, is because most of us, at least according to the dentist, we're supposed to brush our teeth twice a day, right? That's what they tell you, at least. I don't know how many people actually do it. You're supposed to brush your teeth twice a day. And so I like looking at the tube of toothpaste now as this role model of what it looks like to be fully used, right? That you get your money's worth out of something. And I want to challenge you as you go through this life, whether you're the toothpaste person, you're the buffet person, you're the Knoebels late night person, that when you think about getting your money's worth out of something else, to ask yourself, has God effectively gotten his money's worth out of my life? The sacrifice that God made for me at Calvary, what return on investment is God getting in my life? Again, we're not saved by our good works, thank God. We're not kept by our good works. But when we consider the wonderful grace of God and all that he has done for us, is anything he asks of us too much to ask? Right? God is desired for us to be fully used by him. So I want you to consider those things as you go through this life, that you'll be able to serve God well, and with all your being, that when you get to glory, he'll be able to say, well done, my good and faithful servant. I was able to fully use every drop of who you are. That should be our aim as believers. Amen? Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for your word to us this morning. And Lord, again, I thank you so much for the great sacrifice you made for us at Calvary. Lord, that you purchased our redemption, Lord, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but Lord, with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. And Lord, I pray for all of us here today who believe, God, that we would be stirred this morning to be fully and wholly used by you. God, that the investment that you made of the shed blood of Jesus Christ on our behalf to ransom us back to yourself, Lord, that would not be made in vain. Lord, that your grace would not come in vain, but Lord, that we would be able to devote our lives to your service, that every fiber of our being would be devoted to you, and Lord, that you would be able to expend every bit of who we are for your glory and purposes in the earth. God, that we would be those who would serve others, and that we would be able to serve you rather than serving ourselves. Lord, I pray you would help all of us to keep these things in mind as we go through this life, Lord, to be fully and completely devoted to you, Lord, for your glory in this earth. Father, I thank you for your great grace. I thank you for your people here today. Lord, I pray you bless them as they go throughout this week. Father, I ask your blessing upon our event this afternoon. And Lord, we pray that all of this, Lord, would abound for your glory and praise in the earth. And we pray these things now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. Please rise as we prepare to sing our closing song this morning.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me.
Thank you this morning for your goodness and mercies to us, Lord. We want to bless your holy name this morning for all that you've done for us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for giving your life on Calvary for us so that we could be saved, Lord, and we could serve you and worship you, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity to come to church and serve you and worship. We thank you for your many blessings, Lord, that you bestow upon us. We pray now, Lord, you would be with us throughout this day. Be with the youth rally, O God. Keep your hand of protection upon each one. Give strength and encouragement and uplifting to each one. And may, Lord, souls be won into your kingdom through this outreach this afternoon, Lord. We pray you'd go with us as we leave this place. Help us to leave the church, but not leave your presence, Lord, but to take you with us and bring you back as we come back into your service again. And for what you do, we'll praise you, for we ask in your name. Amen. Amen.